I need to try and be quick. It's been really great just listening to all this, really. It's just been amazing. I think it's great to be in a room with all that, more or less half understand each other, more than half understand each other. It's just really great. So just like to say thank you for the opportunity to talk a bit about open government, the approach, participation, and from the civil society side of things. My name is Eric Honore. In my day job, I work in equalities. I work in the fire sector of equalities. So it's quite linked to community safety, a lot to do about discrimination, hate crime, hate incidents, that kind of work. But today I'm wearing a hat, an invisible hat, co-chair for civil society in the open government partnership. That's quite a mouthful, so I should explain that a bit. So we explain a little bit about the open government partnership. It is an international movement. It started back in 2011, 2009 with Barack Obama, technically, if you think about it. The thing that it really does as an approach is quite interesting. It basically champions governments to try some ambitious, innovative, let's say innovations and reforms, and the way it's done is that it is done in a close supervision and oversight by citizens. There's nothing new with that, but the way it's done is actually quite interesting. As the we say, there is an international dimension to it. With 79, it's close to 110 now, but it's always improving over time. So the state has been involved since 2016 as a pioneer. What's interesting is there is a civil society network in Scotland that is, it's mainly online at the moment, but we also are, we meet institutions like this, we collaborate and we challenge government on their commitments. This is really the nutshell of where the civil society approach to open government is actually interesting, and where I think it could actually contribute to the dialogue around community safety. As it is now, I'm not going to go into too much of structures and all that, but really this is how it works. It's really interesting. Especially, we have working groups, we have commitments. Under each of them, you have appointed leads in government that sit next to someone from civil society. Some of them might be independent representatives, people that are in interest, some people that might work in the field. It is that connection between someone who is at the doing edge of policy making and someone who is on the other side, outside the ecosystem. It's these pairs, it's these working groups. This is what this is the approach. This is where it is innovative. It exists in other ways, but this is very, very specific to this project. This is the complete at the moment. As Jerry said, we are currently in the second OGP action plan. It was launched in January 2019. I will not go through the details of the action plan. We don't want to go through this, okay? So I'll focus on something more interesting. This is a quick snapshot of how it happens. There is a forum, it's online. One of the reasons why I'm here today is because we need more people to talk about these things. And I particularly want more people to talk about community safety in an open way. So do sign up, there's details there. It's all about this. It's all about these working groups being focused on specific areas of policy, sitting down with members of government, and actually having conversations. It's this. This is the one thing. I'm going to have to edit a lot of the slides and data today because a lot has been covered already. So that's good because I want to focus on narratives. This is really what the open government approach can bring. It's about recreating these narratives between the government policy makers and civil society out there. So what's actually being tackled in this movement? Doreen already mentioned it's the issue of trust. It's distrust, really. It's if you would say the problem of misinformation. You would say it's also the perception and, to a certain extent, the reality of the needs of the elites being catered for to the detriment of ordinary citizens. That's something which is really Dominic. He said this, that this is what Sanjay Kavan said, was mainly the main cause behind the loss of faith in government. So that was in 2017. So we're talking, it's a bit before Cambridge Analytica. It is still after WikiLeaks. It's still in the middle of fake news. Yes, we're floating around in a soup of misinformation. And it has polarized a lot of people. But this is not new. This is something that I really wanted to get to grips with as well. This is not new. There's always been a problem around misinformation and trust in government. So the quote that I really like at the moment is this one. I'll read it because it's fantastic. A popular government without popular information or the means of acquiring it is but a prologue to a farce or a tragedy, or perhaps both. Knowledge will forever govern ignorance, and the people who mean to be their own governors must arm themselves with the knowledge which knowledge gives. Amazing. Anyone know where it's from? It comes from 1822, which is James Madison. That was a long time ago. It's what led to the freedom of information in America. I think it applies not just to America, and nearly 200 years later, I think it still applies here now. So really, what's really being tackled by open government? It's about diffusing this atmosphere of mistrust. Who is saying what? Can we trust this? Is it a man being manipulated by this? And this is what, from the civil society side, I would say that's where your interest lies. You really want to be on the part of, I want to know this is right. I want to know it relates to me. It is said in a language that I understand. It applies to my life. I can trust this. So that's what is being tackled, really. So that's the open mistrust. That's what it's all about. I use this analogy. I still have to work at it, so you might guinea pigs. When I work in communities, about there is a big romanticism about the access code. I think it's fantastic. It's a fantastic thing that Scotland has, that you can access most of the land of Scotland. You can walk, you can travel from A to B, you can use it for education, you can technically, so long as you stay within laws, you can access most land. It should be the same for government, technically. It is your state. So to map that over, citizens ought to have a right to know and scrutinize the government, wherever it happens, in whatever forms it happens, and to also inspect the decision-making processes. It's not something odd. It ought to happen. Actually, that would bring a lot of pride in government. So this is a tool that I use when I talk a little bit about from government. People that say, what are you talking about? Why are you doing this? So that happens quite a lot in my work, trying to say out there. So this is the action plan. I won't go over the same details of the action plan. As those commitments. Today, there's quite a lot of transparency, as you can see. Brexit is a big issue, although I mentioned it, sorry. But number two and three are really relevant to today. It's the participation framework. Doreen has mentioned that a little bit. And the counter side of that is obviously data literacy. I see them as the two sides of the same coin. We really need to provide information that actually makes sense. So it's not just about publishing data, but it's also making sure that it does make sense. It is relevant to people's lives. So on that one, I'll take a really good example. This is really great. This is the data lab. This is quite recent. Someone decided to make available news of information and data on traffic accidents. Just, I think the whole of UK's traffic accidents across 20 years, you can see now. This is someone who decided, oh, this is great, exciting. I can look at that, I can make some magic. And they managed to map, I'm sorry it's really bad, but you can have it look online. This is compared to Edinburgh, Glasgow. You can see that you're very likely to have an accident in the morning in Glasgow. In the morning in Europe or in the evening in Glasgow. You can expect to have an accident in August in Edinburgh, where there's a festival, or in December in Glasgow. So this is someone who just took the data and was like, oh, it's great, it's here. I can analyze that, I can put it out there, and people can feedback on it. It could apply to community safety in all kinds of ways. You'll have to obviously have some considerations about privacy, about the impacts of that data being out there. It could lower your insurance premiums, or it could then go higher. We need to put safeguards on when we put information out there. But it's a bit about this. You put things out there, you make it available by infrastructure, and it's a good thing. But it's not enough. Really is not enough. The government has moved beyond this idea of it's just about making data available. It's not just data, it's data use and information. So where it's going to is more about, so this is called open dialogue. See, I quite like it because it summarizes all the different concepts around open government, open policy making in a nice neat package. This is from Tom Lennon, from Canada. He's got a lot of resources online. There's podcasts, there's slides and things. Really interesting to read. And his take on it is open dialogue. It's congealing processes of consultation, so that actually deliberation to decision is completely inside. It doesn't drop out of you. We can see what's happening. And that is something that, if you think about what's happened, a lot of consultation, it tends to be government decides we need to know about this. It goes out and sees some citizens about it, consults them, and then goes, great, thank you for your time. We go back behind doors, and then we decide. Sometimes you hear back from it. The open dialogue approach is a bit further out there. It is this question of you go out there with the decision with the possible decisions in your pocket, and the people that are taking decisions sit with members of civil society and decide and discuss on the day. It's bringing decision making a bit closer to the people that it might involve. In theory, it's not entirely there yet, but technically, this is what's slightly different about the open government approach as it's being proposed. Now, this is again nothing new, as I can say. Okay, we talked about this early on. It's the first line to see that we identify and involve people and organizations that are affected by the focus of engagement. It's slightly different, but it's still present in the IoT standards, which are more relevant to OGP. But you will see in those standards, decision making is really named, it's renamed, and it's re-emphasized. So this is where I guess we can say there's a slightly different approach in open government kind of techniques. We really want to get decision making really close to the citizen and be that transparent about it. It's really talking about that and making that clear. In my opinion, this is really where you could rebuild more trust because people can see the decision being taken in front of their eyes. They might not have a complete influence on it, on the outcome, but at least their view should be, let's say, fairly heard. And that's where it's slightly different. So, more diagrams. We were talking a little bit earlier on about town halls and mini projects and all that. So this is hybrid dialogues, I think you mentioned this. This is really interesting. I think this is where we're getting now. The working group technically comes from government, policymakers, but let's say the deciding group that actually needs to know more about an issue. The next stage is expanding into the town halls. Okay, this is Canada, so the community centers whatsoever, but we have to expand to the next stage. We need enough people to do this bit where we spend a lot of time with not experts, not representatives, not gatekeepers, but real people of all different types of people, ages, genders, ethnicities. And we need this. We need this area of, we need enough people to do it. That's technically it. It's really as simple as that. We need people to do this correctly. Where it's different is that the narrative of policymakers is merging with the narrative of a lot of people on the ground, as well as real facts and data. about the issues being discussed. Not not students and versus, not random spins and sound bites, but actual detail on what we're talking, with the narrative of the decision makers and the narrative of actual citizens. This is where it's different. It allows a different narrative to be recreated from experience and fact. So which is the informal participation model. I think this is a really good way of summarizing a lot of the different forms it takes. There's many public, there's citizen assemblies, there's sometimes just informal chats between 6 or 7 people trying to just tackle an issue and just trying to get around to it. So my day job is about a little bit using public survey data with priority groups, and I sit down with people that at local level might be able to change one type of practice. So really, I think that's where we're getting at. I don't think we have got to the stage where we're using that for community safety yet. We do it a bit, we do a lot of that. I'm not sure so far we have had a town hall meeting. We've had hustings at some point, I'm sure, but a town hall meeting where elected representatives who actually could make a decision would actually sit down with members of the public into a wider public. It could happen. There's not, as Lauren said, there's not a lot of elected representatives. They would be overworked. So I don't know what's the solution, but what if it could work? Is it something that this network can tap into? I don't have a solution, so I'm just here to say that from the civil society side, I think a lot of people would like to do this. We organized things during the local elections and general elections a few years back. It was the first equality hustings that took place in a long time. From both the citizens and from the representatives who were there, they were really happy to have occasions to do it. Maybe we just need more of that, and just really have the time and effort and staffing to actually do it, and that must actually change a lot of the narratives. I think there's a first for that from civil society. So that's more or less where I'd like to get to. So I like this bright, let's say, diagram on the rules of engagement. It's really interesting. It's quite clear. Citizen-initiated dialogue tends to be more empowering. It's more about the group that has been pushed to the margin. It's always been like that. It's not necessarily meaningful for government. We need to get to that middle ground in between, and this would happen by a lot of these conversations. There's a really, I like things that are free, because it's really easy to remember. Instinctive engagement is something that is immediate to communities. It makes sense to them there and then. It's direct. It's not something that is suddenly implemented on them. Constructive is where it can actually start to create impact and influence decisions. We need to get a lot more to work constructive. But those are silos, inequality, failed, there's loads of equality silos that have been stuck on one side, and that's because of modeling more, also a more constructive debate. But we certainly need government to be way more reassuring. We need to have more transparent processes. We need to have much clearer access to very clear information that's being used for decisions. And then somewhere in the middle, I think civil society and government will definitely meet and have something constructive going on. So yeah, that's my talk. So I'll stop there because it's much. Thank you.